bias to action, growth mindset, satu lagi apa? Can anyone recall Dennis maybe?
Motivation, motivation.
Kan beb. Dennis, halo Dennis. Panggilan kepada anak itu.
Self-learner.
Yes, self-learner. So, if you're talking about the benchmark of getting a candidate, basically ada tiga major points itu tentang bias to action, growth mindset, and self-learner. From here, Chandra, do you have any, maybe like, what's still like your pain points on actually determining the benchmark itself from three major things that we already stated?
Yeah, how actually the right way to detect those?
Okay, it's actually very easy. For example, in an interview, if you want to detect like a growth mindset, before even the interview, you can actually see from the CV. Kamu bisa lihat kayak based on their experience. For example, there's a person that worked in the hospitality industry for the entire 10 years. You gotta see whether this person itu develop nggak di roles yang dia lakukan. Misalkan dalam hal online guest support. Some people are just stating on the CV that I've been working as a host, as an online guest support for the entire 10 years, and that's it. But actually, you can detect growth mindset by actually looking the roles. Okay, dalam 10 tahun ini, dalam industri pariwisata, at first I was a trainee. And then within a few certain times, I was promoted to become this and this and this. So the way that they develop from the roles that they're working for itself, itu sebenarnya detect growth mindset sendiri. Other than that, based on, itu kan based on CV that's already stated. On an interview, if you want to detect a growth mindset, you can actually ask, like, how do you see yourself in 5 years, the next 5 years? It's actually detect whether this person have a growth mindset itself. Don't be surprised, because a lot of people basically just like answer, well, I want to be successful. That's a very common and general answers. But the answers that we're looking for is that if somebody's actually have a certain way of answering that particular questions. For example, in 5 years, I want to be like a very professional digital marketer. And then you can actually ask again and drill down further, like how are you going to be a professional digital marketer? And then they're going to actually say that, oh yes, I'm going to, the first year, I'm going to join a company. Second year, I'm going to be like a senior in that company. And the third year, I'm going to start my own company. In that sense, then you actually detect not growth mindset, but also like self-learner and bias to actions. Why? Bias to action, not really, but you can already see how this person have perspective, like shift mindnya dia, kerangka berpikirnya itu udah on tracks on three both things. Self-learner, okay, that's from growth mindset ya. Nomor satu yang bisa detect from interview, that's I, Vita, from that. And then bias to action itself, kalau kamu bingung gimana caranya aku detect bias to action, it's actually also very easy. When you had an interview, you can actually ask, okay, so what are the things that you did that from a previous job that you think is not exist yet, but then you do something about it. And then they're going to start to say that, oh ya, jadi sebelumnya itu nggak ada regulasi terkait hari off misalkan, atau nggak ada regulasi terkait BPJS, and then I am the one that is picking up about that to the company, so that the tech bias to action also. Or you can also, as simple as saying that, what are the problems that you are facing in the previous company, and then what, how do you actually handle that? That also, like, you can see how good this person had a bias to action. Itu yang kedua. Terus yang ketiga, for self-learner, maybe I'd like to start. Starting from yang udah pernah interview. Baru Chandra. Oke deh, gak apa-apa Chandra dulu. How do you think you can detect a self-learner from a person?
From the CV part?
Apa?
From the CV?
Okay, gimana tuh?
I think if we would like to detect how the self-learner traits exist in somebody, maybe we could detect it first from the CV, whether they are putting like some courses or learning that they are doing outside the university activities, And if we are talking about the interview, maybe we can ask like maybe we can ask like how's actually you are bagaimana kamu kayak menghadapi situasi di mana you are lack of knowledge.
Okay, so situasi lack of knowledge. Okay, so that's from interviewing ya kalau detecting situasi. Okay, maybe I'd like to start from Luki. How do you think you can detect a self-learner part from a candidate?
Kalau dari interview, biasanya sih pengalaman aku itu dia punya inisiatif yang tinggi nggak gitu ketika misalkan dihadapkan dalam suatu kerjaan atau suatu situasi gitu, misalkan dia ada kalau ketika dia menceritakan pengalamannya itu kita bisa, biasanya aku detect dari inisiatif dia ketika misalkan di posisi yang sekarang ini gitu, apakah dia ada inisiatif untuk bertanya atau melakukan sesuatu, itu biasanya dari yang self learner-nya itu mungkin ada sedikit inisiatif seperti itu.
So it's like the way you detecting itu berarti secara tersirat ya, because you're detecting from the from the way that they talked about experience on facing problems gitu.
Ya. Yeah.
Oke.
Okay. Itu ada indikator basically. Indikator-indikator kata-katanya sih kalau misalkan dia benar-benar melakukan itu pasti nggak akan ada kata jika atau misal if kalau misalkan ketika interview itu gitu, berarti kan itu dia ngawang. Kalau misalkan dia aku make sure-nya lagi biasanya itu ketika misalkan statement dia itu ketika dia menyebutkan detail waktu kapan dan tempatnya, itu berarti dia benar-benar melakukan. Tapi kalau misalkan yang enggak, dia agak ngawang, jawaban yang ngawang gitu, if terus okay. Ya kayak gitu.
Okay. Okay. I'd like to start from Chandra's answers about courses. Yes, that's from CV. I would agree. Like, what are the things that they did? Like, for example, misalkan dia orang engineer, terus dia bilang kayak, I'm actually also learning about Germans or Dutch languages. So, which is, it means that this person has a curiosity and had a self-learning terms. And also that about situasi of lack dari knowledge-nya dia. Okay, I would say that's okay. Also like yang Luffy tadi bilang detecting from based on their story. Tapi sebenarnya there is a simpler way to actually detect if somebody actually have a self-learner part or not. How? Is that you can simply ask like, what have you been learning for this past 2 weeks? And new things that you are learning. And then they're going to start to say that, oh yeah, actually I've been learning about this HTML stuff or coding or whatever. In that case, then you can drill more like, okay, so what exactly that you get within these two weeks, gitu kan? And then yeah, I think that's the easiest way for you guys to detect if a person have a self-learner part or not. Okay, so we've already discussed about the three major points, and then like I'd like to start from Nadine maybe. Basically for now, before, it's like we discussed about interviewing. What are the pain points that you're facing on interviewing people?
Is it the obstacle? Kalau aku sih, aku sebetulnya belum pernah wawancara orang. Pernah deh. Tapi nggak pernah yang secara formal seperti yang biasa ke arah did. Aku orang yang cepat puas dengan jawaban kandidat. Jadi kadang belum nggak bisa ngedrill lagi itu. Itu sih obstacle-nya. Jadi mencari celah untuk ngedrillnya itu yang kadang belum keluar apa ya sense-nya gitu loh. Jadi kalau jawaban dia bagus, padahal itu cuma permainan kata-kata atau permainan bahasa yang dia keluarkan, aku bisa puas. Gitu.
Okay, goes to Lucky maybe. What are the pain points of, from you that from interviewing candidates?
The problem? Usually if I interviewing someone who older than me, so kayak ada apa ya, rasa sungkan atau segan, takut kayak gimana gitu kalau misalkan menginterview orang yang lebih di atas itu, jadinya agak jadi kaku aja, mati gaya gitu. Beda kalau misalkan terus yang teman misalnya seumuran ataupun yang lebih di bawah umurnya gitu. Jadi apalagi kalau misalkan kita melihat kandidat mungkin di CV-nya yang experience dan pengalaman kerjanya lebih gitu, itu yang bikin jadi agak jiper duluan sih.
Oke, kalau dari Dennis, what are your key point, main problems that you're facing? Anak Dennis, kamu nggak bisa ngomong ya? Lagi pembekalan ya? Oke, ya udah. Oke, okay, maybe I'd like to start from Nadine terkait nge-drill. I'll actually going to talk about how to drill better in the next few slides after this, and then responding to Lucky about interviewing someone older than me. Maybe Vita, do you have any advice for Lucky, or do you have any insights for Lucky on how to make to build confidence to interview somebody with better or bigger or much experience and even older than you are?
Actually, that's even for me, that's even more a better for me. Like, for example, when I'm interviewing someone that has more experience or someone that is older, because it is way better for you to be vulnerable. Like, you just like just admit that you don't know, and then ask the person to actually explain. Let's say, since I don't know, let's say in my case, right, let's say about digital marketing, for example, I honestly don't know much about digital marketing. Could you tell me like what you know about digital marketing? And that, like, I actually happier to interview someone who has more information on the application or on the CV, because that's actually the gold mine for you to dig more. Because if you ask me what my problems if I'm interviewing people is actually if they're mediocre in a way that they're saying is just like enough, but like not anything that I can drill on. Like, for example, I ask them to introduce themselves, and then they just say, oh yeah, I just graduated and then now I'm doing this. So it's kind of like, what else should I ask, right? And then it somehow lead into like I'm left with no decision, like or not I want to hire or not. So therefore, and then I pass it to Ara for second opinion, because somehow when you cannot drill, you're satisfied with what their answers. But when you can drill, that's actually a thing. So to answer how to actually interview someone that has more experience or older, that's actually the goal line, but just being vulnerable that you don't know. So the part is for them to explain to you what they know.
Yeah. Okay, adding up to that, I'm really agree with Vita in the sense that you don't always to be smarter than the candidate, because, and that's very normal. It's like there is this saying by Steve Jobs that we discussed on the HR Syncup just yesterday that says we hire smart people not actually for telling them what to do, but we hire smart people to tell them to make them tell us what to do. So in that case, as an interviewee, I think it's very okay to ask them like the simplest things, like for example, digital marketer as already said by Vita, or any other roles that pretend that I am a 5 years old kid that doesn't know a thing about your expertise. So can you tell me about this? And then by their answer, actually you can detect a lot of things, whether from the way that they explain it to us. Is it like as efficient? Is it like as effective? Is it like as well understood, easy to understand? So in that case, we can also detect whether this person has the correct critical thinkings, and also like, is it the candidates that we're looking for or not? So from here, Chandra, do you have any questions?
Okay.
Okay. Is there any further discussion, maybe, like, what are been troubling your mind about interviewing people at from this point to everyone? Luki?
Biasanya yang suka, oh ya, kalau if the candidate are passive, like they just answer straight to the point, then yeah, sometimes it's hard to for me to build another or set another question for the candidate. So like jawabnya ya enggak biasa aja, udah kayak gitu. Jadi bingung lagi kalau misalkan mau nanya itu kayak gimana. Terus sih biasanya gimana caranya ya kalau misalkan menghadapi hal itu seperti apa biasanya?
Interesting. So I'd like to go to Chandra. If there's a candidate that is passive and talks and answer things effective dan efisien seperti itu, terlalu limited, what are the red flags that you're detecting from this? Maybe goes to Chandra.
If there is a candidate that is simply answer a question without explaining, I could detect that they are not really interested actually.
Okay. What are the other things?
And they are not really would like to engage with the interviewer.
Mm-hmm. Okay, not interested. I wouldn't say that's entirely true, but okay, let's go to Nadine maybe. What do you detect if somebody is actually behaving that way?
I do agree with Kak Chandra. The candidates might be not really interested with the company, or maybe the candidate doesn't have a growth mindset.
How is that so? Kenapa nggak growth mindset?
Like kalau misalnya orang yang punya growth mindset itu sih dari hal-hal kecil itu pasti mungkin kedetect juga, like in conversation itu pasti dia juga mudah untuk mengembangkan percakapan, apalagi interview itu adalah kesempatan buat dirinya untuk menunjukkan siapa dirinya. Harusnya dalam conversation itu bisa berkembang terus untuk menunjukkan bahwa dia tuh pantas di company itu gitu loh. Berarti dia enggak growth gitu loh mindsetnya kalau dia cuma jawab ya enggak cuma biasa-biasa aja. Ya satu, whether dia enggak interested atau dia memang enggak growth gitu mindsetnya.
Okay, so for me, I would add up like, actually, you have to know and understand first, like, why is this candidate only telling a few things? Kalau misalkan tadi kata Chandra, apa, not interested, maybe yes, but also maybe the candidate think is not comfortable with you as an interviewee. And also might probably, he's a shy person. It's not that he's not interested, but he's a shy person and he's just happened to, like, don't know what to tell and things like that. So in that case, hi sir.
Welcome. Hey, how's it going?
Cool. Okay, so maybe Tufita, do you have anything to add up on how to actually handle a person that is, a candidate that is so passive?
Basically, it depends on like the type of CV, right? If the candidate is like looking good on CV, you can try to give more chance to the candidate to explore and help to understand the situation or like what is it that you are expecting from the candidate. But if the candidate doesn't seem to actually, you know, like open up or give more ideas, I'm not giving any more further time for the candidate. I'll just stop the interview and ask, do you still want to continue the interview or not? Because I'm trying to get to know you, so you help me to get to understand you better as well. But I don't seem like actually you are going that way, so there is no point for us to have this interview. So yeah.
Jebret ya.
Yes, maybe from Luki, do you have following questions to your previous questions about that?
Yeah. Mungkin ada beberapa yang mungkin nggak tertarik karena jawabnya, tapi kalau misalkan dalam istilahnya karakter kandidatnya emang introvert garis keras kayak aku gitu.
No, you're not. I don't think so.
Yang introvert gitu atau yang misalkan emang benar tadi kata misalkan shy gitu kan, itu kan emang nggak bisa ngoreknya secara langsung kayak kita bikin dia nyaman atau misalkan mau mengungkapkan siapa dirinya itu nggak bisa langsung, tapi misalkan kita lihat dari CV-nya itu dia potensiable banget, gitu. Jadi misalkan emang dari CV-nya bagus nih gitu misalkan, tapi emang pas di interview itu kayak itu orangnya emang karakter orangnya, kan kadang dari situ kita bikin pengen ngorek-ngorek dianya tuh yang susah tuh bagaimana nih.
Yes, if I
can. You need to differentiate first whether this person is passive or whether this person is shy. Because when somebody is shy, it's not that they don't want to answer, but they're kind of like nervous, like gagap, something like that, right? When they're answering. But if they're shy, you can still help. Like, hey, it's okay. You don't need to be nervous. Like, it's a casual or it's like, let's say, just act like we're talking as friends right now. Because that's what we do, right? Like, and then if it actually seems like passive, that's why like what I said, like, hey, I'm trying to get to know you, can you also like help to get to know you better by answering, like, let's say, can you explain more and blah blah blah, things like that.
Okay.
Yes, go to Chandra.
Is there any way we can detect whether the candidate is shy or maybe they are have the introvert characteristic or they are not comfortable with us? Is there any way to differentiate these traits?
Okay. So differentiate whether it's the candidate is shy or highly introverted. Basically, you can sense from two things. First, from the way that they answer, like the way that they answer verbally and non-verbally. Yeah? For example, if somebody is actually the gesture, you know, body gesture. This is also like the things that we need to also understand, that there are things how people are at some point. For example, yeah, you can see from the eyes, from interviewing candidates, whether you have to pay attention on whether this candidate is actually looking at you the entire interview like this, or they're like going like whatever. That also means that they're not actually comfortable. Another thing is that like body gestures on how they like always like closing their hands like this. This is on-site interview, see. Tapi for facial expression, it can be actually detected on interview juga. Then it is something that indeed needs to be diasah, apa ya? Needs to be diasah by the time to understand better whether this candidate motivated but shy or just lack of motivation and not really interested. So itu sih, it's something that needs to be diasah. Okay, so maybe from here, let's go to the next slide. What is it? Then. Okay, so did you guys actually watch the materials or videos that I attached on the paper?
Not yet.
Okay, so maybe from here, I'd like to ask first, what do you think is a behavioral interview? We just talked about this previously based on Chandra's question about body gestures and everything. But this is like in general, so maybe starting from Luki, what do you think is behavioral interview actually? Nyontek ya Luki ya, nggak kita dia.
Gimana di translate di Indonesiain, maksudnya gimana ini?
Ya, menurut kamu behavioral interview itu apa?
Itu masih ada behavioralnya, masih bahasa Inggris.
Behavioral apa behavioral?
Perilaku ya?
Ya, perilaku, tingkah laku. So, in that case, what does it mean by behavioral interview?
Waduh, mana jawabnya ya? No idea sih sebenarnya.
Okay, let's
belajar.
What do you think is behavioral interview?
Mungkin behavioral interview itu related a lot to how the candidate behave during their interview.
50% correct, but it needs to be completed more. Goes to Nadine.
Behavioral interview itu menurutku kalau yang udah dari yang aku lihat tonton juga itu tuh memberi interviewer memberikan pertanyaan-pertanyaan yang jawabannya nanti dari kandidat yang bisa mencerminkan behaviornya si kandidatnya itu.
Okay, very well. Yes. Very good. So behavioral interview is not just about body gestures within the interview being conducted, but it's also about how candidates act towards one problem and another, how they make decision, how the way of their thinking actually on facing problems. So this is also like one of type of candidates that can answer looky concern about if a candidate is straightforward, too straightforward and things like that. You can do a behavioral interview. And there are a couple of questions that actually can reflect a behavioral interview. Okay, so before we go to how to be a good interview. So one of the question of behavioral interview that is good to actually helping tadi yang problemnya Luki yang kalau kandidatnya terlalu straightforward and everything, there is one perfect question that you can ask to the candidate. You can ask actually, usually kan kita tanya, do you have any other question that you'd like to ask me after the interview, right? But actually before you ask that, you can ask, okay, so is there any question that I didn't ask you yet? So in that case, you can see that whether this person actually willing to tell you further and more about what are their interests and then how they actually want to be asked. And in that sense, you can also see how they shape their mind. Misalkan nih, as a host, aku interview host. Jadi jawabnya, ya, gitu kan, yang singkat-singkat gitu. Terus aku tanya nih, is there a question that I haven't asked you? Kalau misalkan dia tetap jawabnya, no, then it's exactly that they're not really is that interested or motivated to be here. Tapi kalau misalkan mereka like sharing insights, that is actually can be possible and interesting. For example, as a host, terus mereka bilang kayak, yes, you actually skipped to ask about my experiences as a host. Or I thought you should have asked me about my previous work in a different industry. That is really possible. I've been trying to apply this to my interviews and you will be surprised on how people actually answer to that. Yes, 80-70% people will say no because they basically like, ya terserah kamu, kamu mau nanya aku apa, right? But to actually get a very interesting candidate is the one that actually determine like, sebenarnya you should have asked me this, you should have asked me that. That is actually how to detect that you have such a good candidate. Karena memang mayoritas orang bakalan tanya, bakalan bilang no when I ask. Ada pertanyaan belum aku tanyain, dia bakalan bilang no. But that's one of the behavioral interviews that can actually be administered to the candidates. Other than that, maybe I'd like to start from Chandra. Can you think of, did you watch the videos belum ya?
Not yet.
Okay, so maybe from Chandra, can you think of a question that can actually reflect a behavioral interview?
Aku nyontek, boleh gak?
Based ini aja, based on what you did, kan you've already interviewed a couple of people, right?
I'm usually asking them about, is the problem solving part also behavioral thing?
Kenapa?
Problem solving.
Yes. Kayak gimana tuh?
So usually aku tanya mereka kayak, what is the difficult situation that you have faced during your previous works and how did you solve that or how did you come up with the solutions?
Yes, that's exactly one type of behavioral interview. I'd like to ask you, what are you trying to detect from actually asking that to a candidate?
I'm trying to how reliable they are and how they could solve the problem in the field things. Misalnya untuk OGS gitu sih, atau host. problem solving.
Okay, maybe to Luki. What one question that you can imagine to test a behavioral interview?
Bentar. Oh ya, biasanya misalkan kalau aku dan pemecahannya seperti apa, dari situ sih bisa basically ya, kalau aku tanya dari pengalamannya, lihat dari pengalaman pemecahan masalah yang dia hadapi sebelumnya, itu bagaimana dia memecahkannya, apakah dia ya tipikal yang bodoh amat ataupun yang ngajak orang-orang buat diskusi buat memecahkan masalah atau yang seperti apa. Itu biasanya dari pertanyaan itu sih, dari pemecahan masalahnya.
Sama berarti kayak Chandra ya? Other than that maybe?
Hobby.
Okay, you're asking about hobby. What are you trying to detect from that question?
Dari hobi, mungkin yang misalkan dari hobinya itu bisa dia kegiatan, dia tuh senangnya seperti apa. Misalkan hobi saya dugem, mabok gitu kan, misalkan social drinker atau apa. Oh, berarti dia emang anaknya yang sosialita gitu kan. Yang mungkin nanti impact-nya juga ada ke kantornya, nanti mungkin bisa kelihatan lah gimana sih karakternya dari yang kayak dari hobi sih sebenarnya. Bisa, atau misalkan saya sukanya ini renang, badminton, lari, sporty.
Okay.
Jadi dia orangnya menjaga kesehatan kayak gitu. Mungkin ya. Gitu.
Okay. True, yes, it is correct. So that's also one type of behavioral interview questions that you can administer to the candidates. And what you're trying to detect is actually their interest. So why interest is important? It is to detect and see whether this person is actually having a culture fit with the company or not. So Mrs. Z is, for example, a host. Yeah, aku pernah tanya ada host itu apply. Terus aku by the end of the interview, I asked, okay, so aku nanya gini, is there anything interesting outside works that you do currently? And then he said that, yeah, I kind of like to read. And then I was like, okay, what type of things that you love to read about? And then he said that, yeah, I love to read something about math, can you believe? So it's like something in that sense that I detect that this person is actually not as sociable as we expect, right? Because why? Reading itself doesn't require another person to actually interact, right? So just you and the book without actually having any social interactions in that type of activity. So in that sense, then you might probably detect if somebody is too focused on things that they like to read, and which is especially it's not related to hospitality or tourism and things like that, then it might be a person that is one detection that doesn't really like, not really that eager to have social type of interactions. So yes, I do agree to Luki. Maybe goes to Nadine first, like what is your, since Nadine udah nonton nih videonya nih, so what is your favorite question of behavioral interview?
There is a lot of questions sih, my favorite question. Satu itu yang I actually sering dengar ke arah menanyakan ini when ke arah interviewing someone, kayak kalau kamu punya alat teleportasi, kamu akan taruh satu di mana dan satu lagi di mana. Selama ini itu aku yang cuma dengar sering dengar ke arah interview orang kayak gitu, kayak penasaran apa sih ke arah, random banget nanyanya kayak gitu. Cuma setelah aku tadi nonton videonya, ternyata itu juga membantu banget untuk mendetek seberapa kreatif orang ini, seberapa growth mindsetnya orang ini, dan seberapa out of the boxnya pemikiran orang ini gitu sih. Itu sih yang sampai sekarang masih jadi my favorite question dari video yang tadi.
Okay, so yeah, basically that's also part of my favorite questions, because by asking like, aku punya dua device teleportasi nih, kamu mau taruh di mana? And most of, this is interesting because most of people directly thinking about a place that they want to visit. And it's always, most of the time, it's about country, you know? So like, I always want to go to US, so I want to put it in the US. Or I want to visit Eiffel Tower, so I want to put it in Paris in my home and things like that. But surprisingly, there are people that actually say that I would put it one in my home and one in Mars, because I want to explore Mars. I'm that addicted to this planet stuff. So yeah, I want to actually explore more. There's even person that says that if it is allowed and possible, if it really exists, that I'd like to put it one in my home, then one in heaven. So I was like, mau ke surga dia. But that's actually very interesting in that sense. Other than the teleportation devices stuff, the things that I like to answer, to ask from a candidate to see their behavioral things is that, biasanya aku tanya nih gini, what is something you used to believe but no longer to believe? That's a major thing. Some people, if somebody are actually answering with a very casual things like, yeah, I used to believe that Easter, apa tuh misalkan yang perigi-perigi itu nyata, tapi ternyata setelah aku semakin bertubuh besar, aku baru sadar bahwa itu cuma dongeng. Misalkan dia bilang gitu, truth fairy is not really exist. Then I can sense and detect this person is not really that serious. But if somebody answer with a very philosophical way, like for example, I used to believe that religion is something that is needs to be followed and whatever, it's like I have to follow everything that is on the Bible and everything. But now that I started to think that it's actually something that we need to observe, like really understand what exactly it means without actually blindly believing on it. So in that sense that you are actually understanding if somebody punya melihat masa perubahan, the way they think, you know, masa pendewasaan and things like that. And this video is very interesting. It was brought up by Vita. Vita di situ kan? Vita, yes. It was brought up by Vita, and so since like just the one that brought it up, so I'd like to ask, maybe outside the videos itself that I already attached, maybe Vita, do you have any other insights or question that is not on the video that you can actually share with us about detecting a person via behavioral interviews?
If you're talking about behavioral interview, it's like the answer is never wrong or correct, right? Because the thing is, when we are asking about behavioral interview, let's say with Ara's example about if you have two teleportation machines, where would you like to put it? The answer doesn't stop, and the question doesn't stop after the candidate answer, but the follow-up answer that actually, revealing how their mindset works, their thought process works, like you need to ask why. So other question that I like is actually it's really simple, like if you can ask like the candidate, like let's imagine like when you woke up like in the middle of the night and then you found an elephant inside your room, what will you do? So basically, if we broken down the question itself, elephant here is actually representing a problem. Because, you know, you are not expecting any elephant in your room, right? Especially when your room is small and it's in the middle of the night. So how are you going to actually react towards the situation? So basically, it's another way of saying that if you have a problem, how will you solve or react to the situation? But instead of asking like in literal question, you change it into a metaphor, like elephant in this case. So their answer will actually determine how they're actually reacting towards a problem. So for example, I have heard someone actually answering this question with saying, oh, I'm gonna take a selfie with the elephant. It doesn't mean that they're going to take a selfie when they have a problem, right? It's just a way of saying that because we're asking in a metaphorical question, so it means like their answer is also should be understood in a metaphorical answers. So when someone is saying, I'm going to take a selfie with the elephant, meaning that actually the way they approach the situation is in a casual way. Like they're not panicking, like not directly going to the problem itself. So we need to think in a metaphorical way as well. Things like about behavioral interview is like the thing is it can never be just one answer because it's the reasoning that we are trying to look at.
Yeah. Okay, so this type of questions about teleportation device and elephant case might be so strange for a lot of people. Like, okay, Nadine tadi bilang, I heard her asking the question a couple of times, but I was thinking like, why? That's so weird. Hi, Gani. But yeah, it's actually deeper than what it seems in the surface. We're trying to detect deeper and deeper. Okay, so next one. Okay. I'd just like to give like how to be a good interviewer. So this is like a very short things, four things to actually understand how to be a good interviewer. So first, you need to listen. Listen very carefully on what the candidates are saying, like each word, and look up on why they say that and like exactly, yeah, pokoknya every word lah. And then second one is look closer. Pay attention on candidates' behavior during the interview. It's what I meant by actually tadi yang body gestures and then like how they actually answer you. Is it like they're nervous, they're answering you nervously, or they're like answer you dengan santai, santuy, and then like ask why. So you need to drill down yang tadi pertanyaannya si Nadine apa siapa tadi ya, nggak bisa ngedrill, Nadine ya. So cara ngedrill tuh gampang banget. Actually you just need to like keep on asking why. Itu cara bodohnya gitu, kayak cara the easiest way to drill down is ask why on whatever they're saying. That I like to do snorkeling, ask why. Why you like to do snorkeling? Because I love to enjoy. Why do you like to enjoy? Because I love relaxing. Why do you like to relaxing? Because I love to do nothing. Why you like to do nothing? So maybe itu macam-macam ya jawabannya, tapi bisa aja kemungkinan arahnya ke situ. So cara gampangnya buat nge-drill down orang tuh itu tanya why. Keep on asking on, ya dasarnya tanya why. Terus follow. Ini maybe aku mungkin sama Vita punya cara yang beda. Aku gak ngerti Vita agree apa enggak sama yang terakhir. Itu follow. Jadi kalau aku rather than aku driving where the conversation goes. Like habis ini aku bakal nanya ini, habis ini aku nanya ini. No. I'm a type of interviewee that loves to actually let the candidate talks. Let them drive where the conversation goes. Let us discover what they want to show. Jadi kita bisa kok ngedetek hal-hal yang kita cari berdasarkan topik dan bahasan yang ingin mereka sampaikan. Misalkan tadi kita mau ngedetek growth mindset, terus kita harus tanya tentang, okay, kamu tuh apa self learner? Kamu apa yang baru kamu pelajari 2 minggu terakhir? Sebenarnya nggak perlu juga. Kalau misalkan ada kandidat yang terbuka, itu kan pertanyaan-pertanyaan itu kan sebenarnya kayak tadi yang pasif segala macam. Okay, kita punya list of problems. Tapi sebenarnya banyak kandidat yang dia open and you can actually just follow where the conversation going and it can be actually you can detect and keep drill down from that thing sebenarnya. Terus mungkin dari Vita about this I don't know, this is like another perspective from another HR, right? How would you like to actually drive the conversation itself? Is it like you are more driving it, or you let the candidate drive the conversation goals?
Actually, I'm driving the conversation because I like to be the one who has the control. Like, I mean, like, because, you know, come on. I mean, like, because when I'm actually controlling the conversation, it's like, I'm going to actually know what exactly that I want to know. But actually, I would like actually give them a space to talk, like at the end of the interview. So I'll end like my questions with like, okay, that's all that I want to know from your side. Do you have any question? Maybe something that you would like to let me know. And then from that, the candidate can explore themselves.
Okay. that's also very another interesting side from both HR. Maybe from here, like, do you guys have any things to ask regarding how to be like a good interviewer? So far from here, no discussion. Okay, so this is the moment that I will probably
that. Aku mau nanya, kalau misalnya is it good for interviewer kalau misalnya kita punya kandidat pasif kayak tadi itu we show kalau kita nggak interested sama kamu, kita menunjukkan ke kandidatnya pas di saat interviewing juga, itu apa itu a good interviewer atau?
It actually great. Why? Because we need to know like what is the candidate exactly do when we showed non-interested type of behavior. For example, kita udah ngomong nih bla 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 bla. Terus habis itu dia tetap aja pasif pasif pasif. I think it's also like one thing that I will do is that I will start to like, okay, now I am going to be like mirroring you in the terms that aku bakalan pasif juga and see how it goes. If the person feels like not comfortable seeing the interviewee change at the same time, tadi dia baik-baik aja terus sekarang jadi it's like a good bad cops, you know. Pertama aku jadi good cops yang okay, I'm happy and whatever, tapi and then like I'm not satisfied as the candidate actually responding to me, then I started to act like a bad cops, then itu bisa jadi sebenarnya malah bagus. Kita bisa lihat inisiatif dia buat bringing the conversation alive or this person would actually keep it dead, gitu sih. Any other question? Nadine? Okay. This is one of the fact aja that actually 60% of our communication is non-verbal. Which is makanya kan sebenarnya sering gak sih misalkan yang sama pacarnya deh pada berantem gitu kan. Biasanya terus bagusnya itu bakalan kayak Vita langsung. Ya atau sama temennya or whoever. Misalkan lagi berantem terus kayak selalu deh kalau aku selalu misalkan berantem gitu aku bakalan bilang kayak okay, this is cannot be discussed and talked over phone, over text. So we have to see each other. This is what I mean exactly by why 60% of our communication is non-verbal. At some point when we're actually having a conversation tuh lebih bagus face to face kan, banyak orang bilang kayak gitu kan, kayak lebih nyelesain masalah tuh lebih enak kalau misalkan langsung, secara langsung or whatever. So in that case, this is what I mean by non-verbal is actually more apa ya, bringing up apa porsinya dia lebih memegang banyak daripada penting daripada komunikasinya itu sendiri, tapi kayak kamu harus tahu gesturnya, ekspresinya dia ketika dia ngomong and things like that, which is can be done on online video call interview. Gitu. Kemudian, okay, this is like gonna be a short tips of interviewing for me. Just gonna be quick, so. So I got 10 key points of interviewing that you guys can follow. So yang pertama, phone screen 15 minutes before and after the time. So things like that, kayak ini buat tahu sih apakah orang ini eager nggak sih buat interview apa enggak. Sebenarnya orang ini siap nggak sih di interview sebelum dan setelah apa telat gitu loh. Kadang kan orang kayak nggak mau ah, aku nggak siap, kok udah cepat nggak diangkat atau things like that. Terus second one, this is what I already did all the time with Vita. Instead of telling the candidates when exactly the interview is going to be held, we let them choose, like kapan. Bahkan ada kandidat yang surprisingly, yang bikin aku gedeg banget itu, setelah di-invite, silahkan sign up di link ini, mereka kayak, jadi kapan interviewnya? In that case, you can already detect that kandidatnya sendiri tuh berarti nggak buka linknya, dia bahkan nggak lihat caranya gimana nge-book schedule interview.
Nggak ikro.
So fine. Ya gimana lu?
Nggak ikro.
Ya nggak ikro. Nggak baca. Kan akhirnya ini. Terus selanjutnya, make sure something goes wrong during the interview. So it is good sometimes that makes them like asking them a wrong question or make them uncomfortable. Itu tadi buat lihat apakah this candidate actually can handle the problems or the unexpected things during the interview. Terus make ton of incorrect assumption. Jadi kamu udah baca nih CV-nya, misalkan Lucky lulusan Harvard gitu kan, terus kamu masih tanyain lagi, oh kamu lulusan Oxford ya, terus kamu ngomong apa-apa, keep on guessing dengan sengaja menyalahkan gitu loh. Ini kenapa, buat apa itu? Jadi kita lihat nih kandidatnya bakal ngeiyayain apa enggak gitu. Jadi itu penting banget buat tahu if the candidate is actually just following atau dia sebenarnya assertive dengan, hey kamu salah, aku lulusan Harvard bukan lulusan Oxford, misalkan gitu. Terus ask the candidate to solve your own specific problems. Ini sama sih kayak yang tadi udah dibahas. Have the interview frequently move between different rooms. Ini kalau offsite sih sebenarnya. Jadi kayak ciptakan situasi yang bikin mereka nggak nyaman gitu loh. Jadi kayak apakah mereka bakalan tetap fokus apa enggak? Terus apakah mereka bakalan tetap excited as the first beginning apa enggak? Terus ini lucu banget nih. Ask the same question over and over again. Kalau lihat contohnya, now that we've talked about your experience, let's talk about your experience again. Jadi kita lihat konsistensinya nih, kira-kira setelah ditanya ini sama nggak? Jangan orang ini bohong. Ini also like how to detect lies, like if the person really go through an experience or not. Terus ini tadi yang udah aku bilang, conduct dual interview being a good cop and bad cop. Sebenarnya buat lihat dia tadi gimana under pressure. Jadi orang ini kira-kira handle the confusion correctly or not. Terus selanjutnya, ask a question then start typing very loudly. Ini buat also distracting a person, rather dia bakalan tetap fokus apa enggak during the interview. So, it can be done also like online, you can like playing with your pen like this, and then like people start to distracted by the sound and then whatever, so it can be done that way. So, here are the, actually the, apa, the tips from me to actually interviewing people. You guys can actually access it again by yourself. Nanti kalau misalkan mau simulasi bisa baca di sini. And then I actually also attach one videos that you can guys watch by your own self before having the simulation. Itu in here. Like you can see how I interview candidates so far. And ini bisa dibuka pakai, diakses pakai akun Bukit Vista sih. Cuman Bukit Vista karena we keep it private, not public. Nanti bisa ditonton sendiri. And that's pretty much it from me. And I want us to get started with the simulation. So now that I'm thinking, since we divided Jogja and Bali, maybe I'd like to kita to schedule with everyone in Bali. Kira-kira kapan mau ini for the third class for the apa this recruiting course. And I will schedule the class also with people in Jogja. So far, maybe apa Pita, you're muted.
I just said, okay.
Okay, so I think this is pretty much a session for the recruiting course from me today. So maybe from you guys, do you have any other feedback or question that you'd like to ask still to me? No?
I would like to say thank you for MPTA for hosting this interview, this recruiting courses, because basically I don't have any experience at all in recruiting. Mm-hmm. And I'm also now currently, you know, become one of the recruiting part from squad 2. So yeah, this is a very good thing for me.
Yay.
I think it's Ara's class. I'm also joining as a student.
Thank you everyone for attending, and also Vita to help me also. So to Lucky, maybe do you have any feedback for me for the course itself?
Can't wait for practice.
Yeah,
can't wait for
practice.
Okay, see ya, bye. Maybe over to Nadine. Do you have any feedback?
This course is really exciting. Same like Lucky, I cannot wait for practicing and the interview simulations. Okay.
Okay then. Maybe quick. Ini dong quick. Apa? This is also like I'm also learning as somebody that is holding a course. I'd like to ask to everyone like, can you score me to 1 to 5 kayak biasa pada sing up gitu? Like how would you score me from the previous course to this course? Like 1 to 5. 1, 2, 3. 4.
Okay. Oh yeah, 5 deh. Daripada yang kemarin.
Denny sempat.
Lebih apa?
For fun today.
Okay. Thank you. Okay. So hopefully the third course, which is the simulation, will be more fun juga ya. Okay. So that's pretty much it from me. Thank you for coming up online and on time to everyone today to attend my class and course. Really do appreciate it, and I wish you have a nice day.